Well, hey, buddy.
Hey, man, how you doing?
God, it's been a while.
It has been a while. Been like 2 weeks.
I know. We took a couple of weeks off.
Tim and Kris,
30 years later, and we still can't get our act together to
not really
get together regularly. We're playing with our old GoPro camera this morning, so look at which one are you in?
I don't know.
I can't tell.
That's pretty cool, though.
It's pretty cool.
It's pretty cool.
So how's things? I haven't seen you in a couple of weeks.
Doing fine. Let's see, what's happened in the last couple of weeks? Really, not much of nothing.
Not much of nothing?
Not much of nothing.
So, you know what, though? When you get our age, not much happening is kind of nice.
It's kind of nice.
Well, hang on, I'm going to turn on the recorder over here now. That's okay. All three of these pick up audio, but then we've got the fancy Nancy. I paid for these things. We're going to use them.
Well, yeah, let's use them.
This is nicer than most of the equipment we had in the radio stations back in the day.
I must say it is. It's very high tech.
Yeah. Anyway, so what I was saying is it's kind of nice when nothing happens.
Right.
I was complaining over the weekend. I never get a day off because I can have nothing planned. Mm. And then this damn thing, you know, can you go look at a house? Can you do this, that, and the other? And so it's kind of nice just to have nothing.
Speaking of houses, let me take a sip of my coffee.
Here, hang on. Oh yeah, I was going to ask you. Why is it every time you come to the office here, you have to take a dump? I'm just curious because you do. You're like my grandson, Archer. I don't know what it is, but when he hears he's going to Bumpaw's house, I'm Bumpaw, by the way.
Bumpaw.
That's how he says it.
Okay.
Whenever he hears he's going to Grandpa's house, on the way, he makes what we call Grandpa a present.
Gotcha.
Looks like a large Hershey's Kiss.
Well, I was on my way here, and dadgummit,
I don't know where it is. You come in that door, and you go, I got to take a dump. I'll be right there.
I do not say that. I say, excuse me, sir. I have to excuse myself.
Excuse me, sir. May I make feces? And you do for, I mean, what seems like hours.
Well, it was an hour. I just find it
interesting that babies and old men en route realize they have to
take a dump. I told you. Okay, we're taking our cat Sable to the vet this afternoon. First vet visit.
Okay.
Okay.
How old is Sable?
17, I think.
This is her first vet visit?
Poor cat. Just a couple years old. But, well, we got her from...
Sable looks at people like with that save me look in her eyes. I'm 17. I've never been to the vet.
No. I think she's a couple years old. We got her from New Leash on Life.
All right.
Which is a very good organization.
Good organization.
Looking for pets. Hey, that's the one to go to.
Yep.
Okay. Let me take another sip of coffee.
Oh, okay. You know what? 40
that's
years ago...
That's mighty fine coming.
40 years ago, if you had told me we'd be in a little bitty office doing this stupid shit with a cup of coffee... I'd have went, man, any planet. So you got your cat.
We got a picture of New Leash on Life,
okay,
which is a fine organization.
Yes.
And she had her shots before we picked her up.
All right.
So we've had her about a year and a half, and so it's time for a visit. It's time for a checkup, make sure she's okay.
Taking her to a new vet.
Yes, and located out here in Madison.
All right.
Not that we're located in Madison, but we are.
Oh, we are, but anyway.
So I thought, well, on the way here, I'll find out where it is.
Okay, you just do a little recon.
Yes.
A little veterinary.
Yes.
Recon.
Well, come to find out, I found the place.
Yeah.
It's probably as far away from here as you can get.
Yeah.
So, of course.
Put that hand down. We've had this discussion.
I'm sorry. And so.
The GoPros are like, what the hell?
And so, anyway, so I was on my way here and driving, you know, listening to music. Everything's cool.
Uh-oh. Turtle sticks his head out of the hole.
Well, no. I didn't want to go quite that bad. Oh, my God. Okay, but anyway, I was kind of squirming. But anyway, everything's cool. Everything's fine. Everything's taken care of.
Okay. So I guess when you're on a car ride of any particular length, I just find it interesting that every time we do one of these, you walk in the front door and go straight to the bathroom.
It's a long way from where we live.
I think we recently had some work done to my house.
Uh-huh.
All right? And so the young Mexican crew that was doing the work, you know, we had a bathroom on that end of the house. It's right off the garage. And we told, hey, if you guys are going to be here, they're painting the house, going to be here a while. If you do need to use the bathroom, you can just come in through the garage and use that one. Every day, Billy, when them boys would, there'd be like five of them.
Uh-huh.
they would line up to go in our bathroom and
do their stuff
and knock it out.
Yeah.
And it, you know, we're like, do you wait till you get here? Because I mean, literally, they get there like 8:30 in the morning.
You mean there's an actual line?
Yeah.
Of guys standing there.
High-fiving each other as they came in and out the door. He said, a nice one, man. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know what you're saying.
I just think that was interesting. I mean, it's a bodily function. You know, I had a science teacher
one time. Can we talk about something else?
No, I like this topic.
Okay.
I had a science teacher one time, this large black lady named Miss Harris.
Huh?
And I was like sixth grade. Miss Harris would stand at the board, and as she wrote on the board, she'd fart. You know,
okay.
It's kind of like a walking fart.
Right.
So she'd be, and we would just giggle, and Ms. Harris would turn around and go, farting is a bodily function. And if you don't fart, your intestines will explode. Anyway.
Well, she's right.
I'll never forget
that. She is right.
And so, you know, Ms. Harris writing on the board, doing that algebra, farting like a banshee. Anyway, so what else is new with you?
Gosh, not much. That's about it, really.
Did you bring something? I brought something for you today.
What'd you
bring? Actually, I brought something for you to see. I'm not going to let you take it because I know it'll disappear.
What is it?
It'll end up in the bathroom downstairs.
What is it?
Let me explain something first.
Okay.
Let me explain.
Yeah, explain it to me.
All right. Back years ago,
uh-huh.
Boys and girls, there used to be these things called newspapers.
Right.
Reel it in there, Bucky.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
It's amazing how when you empty your bowels, you get frisky. And you want to just come over the table.
I'm lighter. I just can't believe it.
You're like fighting in there.
Like a ballerina, man. I'm just ready to go.
Anyway, back before the internets and back before the Facebook and the Googles mm-hmm. and all that, there was this thing called newspapers. You remember them well because we're old. Newspapers were large pieces of paper that they would print the news on.
That's very clever.
Boys and girls, if you go to the Google and look it up, you will see that there was these newspapers. Well, the newspapers had these things called comics.
Mm-hmm.
Remember comics?
I do.
All right. They were usually inside the back page to make them easy to find.
Right.
And again, boys and girls, if you don't know what comics are, they're like little three-panel comic books. Come out every day in the newspaper. Well, you and I, in our infinite quest to find somebody to give us money in our youth, not we haven't changed a hell of a lot.
I haven't changed it at all.
In, I think, 1981, so almost 40 years ago, right?
Okay.
Do the math. That's you good. And I said, hey.
Hi.
I know we were.
Hi.
I mean, I think at the time I was talking to you through the bathroom door.
Probably.
You were in there just to pump it.
Reading the comics.
Reading the comics. So you and I decided to do a comic. Do you remember this?
Mm-hmm.
And so we like, well, what can we do a comic? Because, you know, back then you had like...
Peanuts.
You know, Archie, Peanuts was the big one. Beetle Bailey.
Beetle Bailey.
Little Abner. Really stupid crap, right? And we're like, well, we can write stupid crap as good as
Little Abner is very controversial.
Little Abner was actually, if you go back, I actually have books of like the old Little Abner comics over mm-hmm. the course of like 20. The artwork is incredible.
I know. Little Abner and Pogo. I love the artwork in Pogo.
My favorite is, who was Calvin and Hobbes?
Okay.
Remember the little boy and his imaginary tiger that came to life?
Mm-hmm.
And I love Doonesbury. But anyway, well, I digress. So you and I, we were
Bloom
like,
Bloom County was one of my favorites.
Bloom County was a great one.
Yeah.
You and I, once you came out of that bathroom, and you were very light and very, very on the ball, said, hey, we ought to do a comic strip.
I remember that.
Well, back at, and I'm going to get to it. The way it worked was, you would have to submit the comic strip to these companies called syndicates. And uh-huh. they were the ones that put the comics in the newspapers.
Right.
And your chances of getting a comic accepted were like slim to none.
Yeah.
Right. Did that stop us?
No.
Nay, nay. You know why? Because we were ignorant and broke.
That's right.
Kind of like down.
Somewhat.
You're a little less ignorant. So we did a comic strip. And so we were like, well, what are we going to do it on? Well, we were in radio at the time. That's all we knew was how to be disc jockeys, and we weren't that good at that.
All right.
So we did a comic strip, and I, over the weekend, dug in my closet and found the original drawings.
Oh, you're kidding.
Or as we would call them, drawings.
Drawing.
All right. So this is like unearthing an ancient papyrus.
Wow.
It is literally the original drawings. And so we called it, what do we call it? Airwaves.
Airwaves, remember? Yes.
So let me take this apart. These are the original vellum drawings.
Now you drew this.
I drew this. You wrote it and lettered it because your lettering was much prettier than mine. So, and we'll, I'll post some pictures of this, but this was the actual package that we sent to the syndicate to try to get this published. And we actually got very close.
Wait a minute. Airwaves by Tim Knott. Where's my name?
Oh, yeah. Oh, well, no, that was years later.
Okay. Hold on. Here it is. Wait a minute.
This is the package. Because here. All right. So original drawings.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Yeah.
Look at this. This is the original ink that we sent in. And you can tell I've taken really good care of them.
Oh, yes, you have.
When we did it, it wasn't Airwaves. We were doing KBAT or something. We were trying to come up with a clever
call letter.
Billy and Tim. Right. Yeah. I'd forgotten that. I just thought we were trying to come up with something clever. Anyway, I know you probably can't see these, but you remember these?
These characters
were great. We had a radio guy, and there was a newsman.
It was somewhat KRP-ish.
It was very much like that Knox and Brassfield.
Yeah.
Very much KRP-ish. Yeah, you did the actual lettering.
I've always been able to do...
really pretty lettering.
Thank you, Tim.
Anyway, I found this, and I'm like, whoa, that's because I had tried to do three or four comics myself, and I'm like, I'm not having any luck. Let me get Billy involved here. Maybe the luck of the Irish will.
Obviously, the one that didn't have my name on it.
well, this was the one like 4 years later. You can tell, look at the difference in the characters.
Oh, yeah.
These were updated and redrawn, and I never even bothered to submit that one because I'm like, screw it. But this is the one we submitted.
Right.
And you can see the
difference. And from what I understand, we actually got it's okay.
Well, what happened was we submitted it and we didn't hear anything for several months.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, we were young and ignorant and we wanted people to realize how brilliant we are. Look at they're watching a TV with an antenna on top of it.
I know.
Isn't that funny? And so we called, or I called. You were in the bathroom at the time. So I called him up and I said, hey, we're just trying to find out the status of a submission. And so I don't remember who I talked to. This is 40 years ago. And they said, I remember it. It's gone through. It got through what they call it, review number one. And I guess there were several review periods or whatever.
Right.
And so I remember calling you up and saying, we're in review number one.
Yeah,
which was good news, right?
Yeah.
And so we're like, okay, well, they're going to review it, and then three or four days from now, we'll be in the money.
Right.
Well, three or four days from now, it came back. And I don't know if it was me calling, wanting to know what the hell was going on, or they just said,
I guess they forgot to mail it back to us, and they're like, oh, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, because we got the patent, and these were the originals. We sent them copies, of course. But, yeah, we got the package back, and I got the rejection letter somewhere. It's tear-stained. That basically said, thank you for your submission at this time, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a long
shot.
That
is really cool.
Long shot anyway.
Yeah.
And I do have copies of this for you at the house. I got to dig them out.
I copied them and
put them on smaller paper. But
you should find that rejection letter.
I found those in this big portfolio of artwork that I have.
Wow.
And I think the rejection letter said, thank you for submitting. We blah, 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 but no. But the thing about it is your odds of getting through then were just astronomical.
Right.
And, it was just very, very, very competitive because there was only so many comics in the newspaper. But exactly. We thought we'd made it. I remember that phone call, man.
There for a while, we were somebody.
Yeah, I put my hair up in a ponytail and called you, man. I'm like, we made it through the first review, dude.
We can let ourselves go.
Let's go buy something on credit. Which I think we probably did.
I'm sure we did.
I think you bought a yellow Chevette.
Remember that car? Yeah, I love that car.
The yellow Chevette?
Yeah. Yep. I remember I met this girl one time before Donna. I met this girl one time, and she was intrigued that I was in radio, and she was talking, asking me stuff. She goes,
"What kind of groupie?"
And so she asked me, she said, "What kind of car do you have?" I said, "I have a vet." Really?
Yeah.
I said, "I tell you what, you go out with me. I'll come by and pick you up in it."
It was a canary yellow vet.
Yes, canary yellow Chevette.
But it was a vet, nonetheless.
It was a vet.
I remember that. What did you drive before the?
The first thing she said when she got in the car, she looked around like this. I thought DJs paid more money than this.
What's the most money you ever made?
I never went out with her again.
Huh? What's the most money you ever made as a DJ, as a disc jockey, not doing parties and stuff, but the pinnacle of, I'll tell you, my pinnacle, honestly, was like $5 an hour. And I know you made more than I did, which
is sad. I was like $5.50, I think. We didn't make a lot of money. We really didn't. I think it was all the fun we could eat. You know,
yeah. There were a lot of perks.
There were a lot of perks.
Going out to the clubs and drinking and that sort of thing.
And yeah, what was weird is like after I left TAK, we actually had to pay for dinner.
Yeah,
because we would go to the people that would sponsor us.
Yeah,
come on in, Kris. How you doing, buddy? Yeah,
you would eat and drink for free.
Everything's on us, and we got used to that. That's kind of sweet. So I guess we did get paid, maybe not monetarily. Is that right? Monetarily?
That's a good word.
Thank you. I just made it up. But fun and excitement, you know, like going backstage and meeting people. And I told the story about taking Jake back to meet wrestlers and all this other stuff. And, you know, that was pretty.
But you can't put that in an envelope and send to your mortgage company.
Well, no. They could call
you. Can you imagine Wells Fargo? Oh, here's, we're going to process this gentleman's mortgage payment. Well, there's no money here, but oh, here's a note. Hey, I got to meet
Hulk Hogan.
Iron Maiden. Okay, that's worth
$800. Right. I met Macho Man.
Yeah, we were always broke. I mean, even the last time we worked together, when we did the mornings at TAK, it's $5 an hour.
I know, the first time I met Donna's parents, my wife's parents. They came over to our house, to my house, and I had a dollar bill tacked onto my bulletin board in the kitchen.
Mm-hmm.
And Donna's dad walked over and said, "What's the dollar for?" I said, "That is proof I will never be broke."
Because I got a dollar.
And I look back now, and he's going, "What a loser this guy
is. Can't believe him. What's wrong with my daughter?"
Yeah, what is wrong with you?
I mean, she wants to marry a DJ with a dollar and a dollar cup. What the hell?
Bulletin board. Yeah. But that's a true story. Like I had it up there. It's like, I'll never be broke because I have that dollar.
But, you know, we would always hear the stories of, I mean.
It was desperate times.
Well, the good old days.
Good old days.
I mean, we had fun. But here, speaking of the freebies, I was telling, I guess I was with Sierra, my youngest daughter, this weekend. We're talking about food. We're going out to eat. And I told her, I said, the best meal I have ever had at a restaurant was at this restaurant called Foe's. Remember Foe's?
God, yeah.
And that was when I worked
at Vietnamese.
It was French Vietnamese.
Yes.
And it was just unbelievable.
Yeah, unbelievable.
And the only way we got to eat there was through a trade out with the radio station.
Right.
Because back then, there's no way I could have afforded to eat there. But yeah, and that's funny. I when I was telling this, I said, yeah, the only way I got to eat there was we had a trade out at the radio station because I was making like $5 an hour.
Right.
Because when I met Melissa, which was right about that time, I was literally working three jobs to make ends meet. Literally. I was doing the comedy club, doing the hosting down there, $5. I was the $5 guy.
Mm.
I was being paid $5 an hour. What, 4 hours a night to host
I was working
the comedy
down there too.
Club. Yep.
I think I was before you.
Well, you were. Yep.
Yeah.
Then I was making $5 an hour at TAK to do the radio show. And then I was doing cartoons and writing for, remember the Scoop, the urban newspaper, urban propaganda?
I sold for them. That's my boss.
Oh, my God. Well, you didn't sell much. Hey, I gotta tell you that.
Hey, wait a minute.
Well, remember that. Yeah. So I was working three jobs, making $5, basically $5 an hour at each job.
Yeah.
And I think I was making $50 a day because I was working 10 hours a day.
Well, I did the same thing. I did night gigs. The remotes.
You DJed. You did radio dances and stuff.
Yeah. Just stuff like that. But I worked at the radio station during the day. I always had a gig at night because I would do like I don't know, when the Classic Cafe came to town.
Oh, Classic.
Oh, God, that was awesome. And that's right when karaoke first came to town.
I do remember that.
Remember that?
Yep.
And so that was a Wednesday night thing. That was the place to be. The place was packed.
Oh, yeah.
I spent every Sunday night at the Vapors.
I remember the Vapors.
For 8 years.
Yeah.
Every Sunday night for 8 years we were there.
So Monday you were useless, basically.
I was always late for work.
Yeah, well, you were anyway.
And so, but somebody said that one time. They said, we know how good the party was the night before you were at, depending on how late you were for work. How late you were for work.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's true. But
but you drank free. You never paid for anything.
No.
But there's actually a picture on my Facebook page of you and me at the Classic Cafe. You were doing a remote. There's you, me, Calvin Cribbs. I'm sure Melissa was there. Joe Tannehill was there. But yeah, I'll dig that out. We were much younger.
Yes, we were. Yeah. Much younger and dumber.
Yeah. But we had a good time, though.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
We just didn't make any money.
Didn't make any money. And you were talking about Foe's Cafe or Foe's Restaurant. Foe's, I don't want to get back to that.
Wooden nickel? Wasn't it in the wooden nickel location?
It was, right there on Country Club Drive. Yeah. Right there.
I think it was the old wooden nickel, I think. Okay. Anyway, I digress. It was good. Crockmeyer's? It was the best food. Could have been Crockmeyer's. It was one of those.
But anyway, he came on the show when it first opened
up.
Mr. Foe came on the show and we were talking to him. Talk about Vietnamese cuisine and all this other stuff. And I said, I tell you what, we're going to come down to eat with you tonight, but I want you to cook me up some fried green tomatoes. Son.
He didn't know what you were talking about.
Those were the best fried green tomatoes I've ever had. He put a sauce on it. It was like.
What was that
like
sauce?
Like a lobster sauce.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Because I remember we got steak and shrimp or something. Stuff we never, I hadn't had steak in.
Since it's been on radio.
Since hanging out at Back Steakout. But it was just the best food.
Mm-hmm.
He wasn't in business long.
No.
Because he was giving us free food.
He got deported.
But that was the best. It was really weird. But yeah, Foe's, it was delicious.
Oh, yes. Good stuff.
That was really the only perk I remember from being at TAK. I mean, besides the
club you've heard about my T-shirt closet.
Yeah, I've seen a lot of your T-shirts.
Yes. Now, that's another thing. When you're in radio, you don't ever have to buy a T-shirt. Because every time you turn around, somebody's giving you shirts.
Yeah.
You
know? I remember when I went to work at WJMW for Bill Donovan, which would later become WVNN, I guess, or whatever.
Whatever.
They had just done a big trade out with Mellow Yellow. Mellow Yellow, it was when Mellow Yellow first came out. Remember Mellow Yellow? And Bill had done a trade out, and there was literally a room about as big as this studio stacked floor to ceiling, wall to wall with Mellow Yellow. And you could drink all you wanted.
Oh, yeah.
You could take it. They just wanted it.
It wasn't cold.
They wanted it. Yeah, you could drink all you wanted. And I remember I was peeing Mellow Yellow for years.
Oh, I'm sure.
It was just because it was free.
Well, see, I remember when Mellow Yellow came out because I told a story the other day about the ice plant.
Yes.
I worked at the ice plant when Mellow Yellow first came out. So the guys, we were back in the back, and so our boss came up, hey, guys, here, you know.
Have some free Mellow Yellow.
Oh, it was in the summer. It was hot.
Yeah.
Man, that stuff tasted like gold, man.
Well, that was before all these monster drinks and stuff.
Yeah.
But Mellow Yellow, they just dumped the sugar in there.
It didn't matter. It was great.
It was like Mountain Dew with, like, crack poured in. It was just. Yeah. We drank that whole summer, and the room, it never got any smaller. You know, it would just, you know how you would take one, but it would, like, replenish itself? Mm. But the taste of Mellow Yellow now makes me sick.
Does it?
So what have you got there? You brought a notebook.
I bring this every week. Nothing. Yeah. These are just some fun facts. But anyway, I did have something.
All right.
You know, we do this broadcast, this extravaganza. This
wonderful broadcast.
Yeah, in Alabama. We're in Alabama.
We are in Alabama.
Okay. And let's see. Well, I lost what I was looking for. All right, let me find it. Anyway, keep talking.
Okay, so anyway.
There's my T-shirt closet.
Good Lord, show the camera. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Those are all T-shirts from the good old days?
Uh-huh.
Yep. Well, I told you I have a comedy club sweatshirt. That's in mint condition.
Right.
And I have, a plush horse T-shirt. You always got more than me because you would just, you would take them by the box load.
Oh, here's something we were talking about the other day. We were talking about Andy Griffith.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Remember?
The fact that the only person
I sent you this. It said the reason Mayberry was so peaceful and quiet was because nobody was married. Andy, Aunt B, Barney, Floyd, Howard, Goober, Sam, Ernest T. Bass, Helen, Thelma Lou, Clara, and of course Opie were all single. The only married person was Otis, and he stayed drunk. And you came back.
I
came back with a
Yeah.
Better than that.
Well, when I was doing stand up, I had a whole Mayberry routine, and the highlight of it was the only person to ever have sex in Mayberry was Andy's wife, and it killed her.
That's classic.
That was a great joke. I should have sold that joke to somebody.
You should. Yeah, you should have. That was funny.
I love it. I still watch Andy Griffith.
Andy Griffith, to me, all right, this is going to be a really stupid question. All right.
I will give you an equally intelligent answer.
Okay. Barney or Warren?
Oh, Barney. Without a chance. Absolutely. Warren just got on my nerves.
I wanted to punch him in the face.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah. He had business being in Mayberry.
I don't know what they thought when they hired that guy.
Well, Jack Burns was the guy's name. I don't know how I know this. Holy crap. I can't remember where I put my keys most days, but I can remember. Jack Burns, who was Warren for man. He was he did a stand up with a partner.
Right. Burns and Allen or something like that.
And that was his thing. So he was, and so that's what, but Barney, hands down.
Well, what happened was, from what I understand, Barney and Andy, offset, they had agreed that this was going to be their last season.
Right.
They were going to quit. Both of them were going to quit.
They're going to be movie stars.
Right. Well, Barney went on to quit. And Andy decided he was going to stay. So here's Barney standing outside the door going, whoa, what are you doing? What are you doing? I thought we were quitting together. No, I'm just going to stay for a while. Yeah. So he did. Barney went on to do the Ghost of Mr. Chicken.
Oh, yeah.
And the Apple Dumpling Gang.
And what was the one where he was the fish? Remember, it was the cartoon?
Oh, yeah.
Mr. Limpet or something like that.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah.
But anyway, I tell you, one of the funniest one of the funniest lines to me was when, and it was done by Goober, of all people. Goober. Yeah. Okay. Barney and Andy were both running for sheriff.
Yep.
And they had a debate. And so here's Barney up there just really dogging Andy.
Yeah.
He was talking about the safety features that maybe the protection that Andy provides.
Yeah.
Did you know that in the back, we don't have any military, army weapons and all that stuff? Do you know what's in the back of the trunk in the sheriff's car right now? A shovel and an axe. Goober leans over to Andy, goes, "Ain't you got a jack?"
That just kills me.
That is so funny.
Okay, here's one for you.
Okay.
Goober or Gomer?
Gomer.
Gomer. Hands down?
Hands down.
You didn't like Goober. Judy.
I didn't like him. Yeah. I just thought Gomer was a better character. Yeah. Goober, George Lindsay, grew up in Jasper, Alabama.
Oh, yeah, he's like one of the Alabama celebrities.
Yes, and my dad is from Jasper.
Mm-hmm.
So Daddy told me that because I met George Lindsay when he came here for a telethon.
Did he have his hat on? That little
no.
Joker hat he wore?
No, but he remembered my Uncle Kenneth, my dad's brother, more so than my dad. My dad told me one time that George Lindsay bought a bicycle from him for a quarter.
Seven degrees of Kevin Bacon right there.
But anyway, Goober, when he was on Hee Haw, would invite my Uncle Kenneth down to Nashville to sit there and just watch the taping of Hee Haw.
How fun.
Yeah. But they all grew up together. They're all buddies. Yep.
These local celebrities.
Yeah.
You know what's really funny? What was it? The guy that, who was the guitar player? Remember he'd come through?
George Lindsay.
Who? No,
not George Lindsay.
He was
some Lindsay.
He ended up being on the Dukes of Hazzard. He was like the deputy or something.
Jim Lindsay.
Jim Lindsay. The actor that played him, oddly enough, went on to be one of the most renowned acting coaches in Hollywood.
Really?
And then he ended up being the second to Boss Hogg on the Dukes of Hazzard. I think the lesson there is hope for us.
I think so.
All right. Well, hey, buddy, that's about our
is
time.
That it?
So, yeah. That's,
wow.
That's all I can stand.
Wow. Have your batteries died?
Yep.
Okay.
it's still recording. But it's okay. So,
okay.
All right. So you got a big week. You got to get there and take your cat to the vet.
Yeah, taking the cat to the vet, and that's my day right there.
All right, buddy. I don't know what I got to do. I'm sure
we'll find
there.
Something for you today.
All right. We'll see y'all later.
Bye.
Have fun. Next time. Bye.